This is Mark Kepler with Purdue Extension Service in Fulton County. What we're going to do today is we've traveled out to a garden here in the rural areas of Fulton County. We're going to take a look at what's going on in this garden. There's a lot of pests. There's a lot of diseases that many of us have in our home gardens that we don't even know about, and we don't know really what's going on, and that's exactly what we're going to look at today. We're going to talk about those things that this garden has problems with and some of the things you might want to look for. So let's take a look at them. Well, one of the things that we put into our gardens lots of times are potatoes, something that we plant very early in the year. Many people like to get them in by Good Friday to get them out there. Well, come along this time of the year, those potatoes are already coming to be ripe. They're getting a chance to get close to that time. It's almost ready to dig them up. But one problem that most people don't really realize that they have in their tomatoes is what we're going to take a look at here. As we look down and look at this plants that we have in this garden, these potatoes that we have here are starting to curl up on the end of the leaves. On the end of the leaves, they're starting to curl up out here, and we're starting to see a little bit of it drying up. And most people think that's natural, that's just normal for them to do, but it's not. What's really going on here is there's a little tiny insect called the potato leafhopper that's at work here. If you walk out into your garden and you see your tomato plants out there, and you merely go out and go like this, you have to watch very, very carefully, and little tiny green bugs will come flying off of there. Sometimes when you take a plant, you take the leaf, you take it off, and you turn over and look at the underside of the leaf, you may, and it's kind of rare, it may find some of the young stages of that insect on these bottoms of these leaves. And it's a little tiny green insect. And on these right here, I don't happen to see one right now, but that's what's going on here. What that insect has done, that small little green kind of wedge-shaped insect has done, is it's come out to this leaf, it has stuck its snout into it, and in the process it draws the juices out of the leaf. But before it does that, it injects into the leaf some chemicals that helps it digest that leaf better. Well, those chemicals that have been put into that leaf then will burn that leaf or cause damage to it. And we call this hopper burn. That's a common thing we use. We see this in alfalfa too. Alfalfa is very susceptible to the leafhopper. The leafhopper is an insect that does not spend the winter in this area. In fact, it spends the winter down in Mexico. And it gets up on the jet stream and it flies up here and it drops out of the jet stream every year about the first or second week of June, sometime around then. And so we start seeing hopper burn happening after that. So these plants here have got hopper burn on them. That's what we're taking a look at when we look at these different plants. And there's some little tiny green guys on there that you can see, but most of the time you just kind of knock the leaves like this and you might be able to see those green things going out through that area. It's very hard to see. So what do I do with potato leafhopper? This is where we really need to use an insecticide, something like 7, or another one we call the pyrethrums. And they are very effective on leafhoppers. The old garden 7 would work very well here. Sometimes people like to use the dust. I really don't care to see the dust formulation. I like to see the liquid formulation sprayed on here because that dust really gets them all white and actually stops some of the photosynthesis in my book. So I like what we're looking at. But potato leafhopper, most people don't realize they have it, and that's what we're looking at in this crop here today, and it can be prevented. Once you start seeing this hopper burn, the damage is already done. So it really needs to be starting to look at these plants and sometime in the month of June and maybe potentially spraying them for potato leafhopper. In Fulton County, there are a lot of commercial potatoes raised, and those commercial potatoes have had multiple sprays for potato leafhopper and some other problems too besides that. So that's the first plant we're looking at in this garden, is taking a look at these potatoes. And most people don't know they have it, but that's what's going on. The next crop we're going to take a look at is green beans in a garden. And the reason I'm going to green beans next is because that same insect that I was talking about with potatoes, called the potato leafhopper, will also get on green beans, and it can cause damage on green beans. Again, those leaves can get that hopper burn that I talked about, where the edges are burnt or discolored from that insect. And again, if you go out there and you kind of hit them like this, sometimes you'll see little ones flying off very quickly in that area. One of the other things that happens with green beans, though, is the bean itself, and this bean here is ready to harvest. Sometimes those leafhoppers will get right down here on the bean and suck the juices out of this bean, and you really won't even notice it. And you go to can this, and after this bean has been canned, then you're going to end up seeing little spots all along that bean pod. And that little spots, little white spots along that bean pod, is where that leafhopper has been in there and caused that damage to that plant. So what we're looking at on these green beans is pretty much leafhopper damage. By the way, these green beans are ready to go. They're ready to be harvested, and fairly soon these will need to be either consumed or canned or put away for that. So this is a little bit of a problem with green beans that we run into. In fact, it's the major problem that we run into with green beans along that line. Well, next we're going to take a look at tomatoes. And let's take a look at this tomato plant we have right here before us. This is a very typical tomato plant for this time of year. We are now towards the end of August. And what will normally happen to tomato plants in our area is by the time we get to the end of the August, we start seeing all these leaves at the bottom start to die. And on the way up, you see it started still green at the top, but dead at the bottom. And this is a typical disease that comes into these plants. And I see this over and over again. And this is one of the reasons why we may want to think about utilizing a fungicide for these plants. Now let's take a look at this leaf right here, and let's take a look and we'll take it off. If you take a look at that leaf, it is not burnt back all the way yet. That leaf has got some spots on it, and it's also got some dead tissue on it. Them spots in that dead tissue that we're taking a look at is a disease. The spots pretty much are something called Septoria leaf blight, and the other part of it's called early blight. It's not important remembering these names. What's important is to understand it is a disease that has come into them, and it is not natural for this to occur. And this tomato plant we're looking at here today is very indicative of what happens with that disease. Dies from the bottom up. I always tell people it dies so much that by the time we get to the fall of the year when the frost come, the plant has already died by that time. Well, we can prevent this disease through the use of a fungicide that is referred to as chlorothenil. Now, that's a big long name, chlorothenil is, but lots of times when you go to the store, you can purchase this fungicide in a jug, and it's called Daconil, D-A-C-O-N-I-L. And it's available in our community for this type of disease that we have. The thing to remember is fungicides protect. So this disease started in early. That fungicide should have been put on early to prevent it from getting this disease. Lots of times I find that tomato plants out in the country, and it's windy today, are usually ones that get it less than tomato plants in town, because tomato plants in town don't get as much wind, they don't dry out as quick, and therefore the rain and the wetness stays on the plants longer, and the disease has longer to infect. Well, we talked about two diseases on them, very common diseases. A couple years ago, we had another disease called late blight. When late blight came in, it's very rare, but it happened a few years ago, it just wipes out the whole tomato plants and they're dead. Very, very severe disease. That's the disease that was responsible for the Irish potato famine back in the early 1800s that did a tremendous amount of damage and caused the mass migration of people from Ireland into this area, into the country. So that's late blight, and we don't have that yet this year. It's not in our community. But very, very indicative of that problem is this disease here, Septoria and early blight. And you can do something about it if you want to. Well, while we're still talking on the tomatoes here, I want to get an opportunity to cover a little bit about what's happening with these. And there's different kinds of tomatoes. This is an example of what we call a cherry tomato. A lot of little tomatoes on here. In fact, these are fairly good-sized cherry tomatoes that we're looking at. And a lot of people like cherry tomatoes because it's something I can just pick up and eat and have a bite of. And so we get those kind of tomatoes. On behind it back here is another plant. That plant back here is one that is generally the type of tomatoes we have for sauces. and sauces. They are kind of a firm tomato, not just a soupy kind that you're going to put on your sandwiches and eat raw that way. Lots of times we make tomato sauces out of those types of plants. And so we have different kinds of tomatoes you can plant in your garden. I want to mention a little bit something about this plant back here. As we look into this plant, you'll notice that we've got some red tomatoes on the bottom. We've got some green tomatoes up here. And as we go on up further, we see some brand new tomatoes coming off up here that are being grown on the top or just starting to grow. There are really two different kinds of tomato plants. There are in the way they grow. One is called determinate and the other is called indeterminate. Big terms. But what it amounts to is some plants in their genetics will produce like this and does. A few tomatoes now, a few more later, a few more later, a few more later. On your other tomato plants, it'll put on all their tomatoes at one time. So if you were going to make salsa, or if you were going to go out and can tomatoes, you'd want a plant that was going to put them all on at one time, and that's what we call determinate. But if you want some for your sandwiches every day, then you might want to get a type that just produces all year long, and that would be called an indeterminate. And the way I remember those names are like this. The indeterminate really doesn't know when it's going to end up bearing. It just can't determine when it's going to put on all its fruit, so it puts on some now and some later. The determinate, it knows when it wants to put on its fruit. It's all going to happen at one time. So when you go out to buy your tomato plants, you may want to know what you're dealing with, because it won't say it right there on the label. You may have to do some homework. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But the variety you want depends on what you want. If you want them all at one time, get a determinate. If you want them strung out, get an indeterminate tomato. So a little bit of lesson on buying tomato plants. Okay, well, we're going to get a little bit of chance here to talk about some other things in this garden. In talking to the homeowner right before we came out here, he said, well, we just had pulled out all our pumpkins and squash plants because they were having problems with them. Very, very common disease that we get into our pumpkins and our squash plants is something called powdery mildew. It gets a white powder on the leaves. And that white powder with powdery mildew is something that really will take them out. In the case of pumpkins, we can get varieties that are resistant to that disease, and they are available. And those pumpkin varieties are something that we can have out there in our yard, and so we don't have to worry about them. Otherwise, we've got to spray these pumpkins for that disease. And one of the difficult things about it is, in this community, it's really hard to find the chemicals to spray for these kind of diseases. I really encourage people to take a look at purchasing disease-resistant seed if they can do that. One more thing about this plant. The homeowner pulled it up because it had wilted down and died, and it just assumed that the disease had got into it. As we look at this plant, we can see this white powdery stuff right here on the stem. That's an example of powdery mildew, and powdery mildew will kill it, but it kind of kills it gradually, and you can see the leaves getting very white on it as it goes along. But if a plant like a pumpkin or a squash wilts down, then the thing you do is you take a look at that stem and you start splitting open that stem and you look inside of that stem, because inside of there you're going to find somebody that looks just exactly like that. And that there is a squash vine borer. There has been a moth out here that has laid the egg. The egg has burrowed into the plant. And all you're going to see is this plant start to die down on you and start to wilt away. But really what's going on is this guy is inside of it. Once he's inside this plant, there's not a thing you're going to do about it. The idea is you've got, again, use a type of insecticide to spray these plants early on so that when that moth comes around and lays that egg, it kills it before it goes into that plant. But very common in our area, when you see dead squash or dead pumpkin plants, especially if it's one or two out there in the middle of all the rest of them and they look very good, this is the guy to look for. That's a squash vine borer, and that's what's gotten into this plant and caused the damage here. Really common in a lot of our gardens are things such as broccoli and cabbage and cauliflower, and they all fall into that group of crops we call the coal crops. And as we look here, we've got some broccoli. This broccoli was planted very late, and it really doesn't have any heads, little tiny heads on it. The reason it's got little tiny heads on this broccoli is because of the fact that it was planted so late. They like to grow in the cool weather, and they like to produce those heads during the cool weather. And so maybe as we get into this fall a little bit more, as we get into the cooler weather, this plant survives that long, we can go ahead and utilize that, and it can come on with some broccoli later on in the year. Another thing that we always look at, and it's constantly a problem in these plants, is we take a look at the leaves here, and we got holes in the leaves. There's always some kind of holes. And frankly, these plants are not very bad looking for the holes. And I have seen plants that are just riddled with holes. Well, we get down and we look at this plant and say, what's causing these holes? And the first thing I see right off the bat, right on the top of that leaf, is a worm. There are three kind of worms that get into cabbage and broccoli and cole crops. One of them is called a cabbage looper, one of them is called a diamondback moth, and the other one is called an imported cabbage worm. And so we've got one growing right here on this plant. This is probably an imported cabbage worm. It's very difficult. It's not looping, so I know it's not a looper. And this diamondback moth is a possibility also. They're very hard for me to tell the difference in them, except for when they're mature. But they are insects that get onto these plants, cause holes, and cause problems with them. You can spray for these. And in this case, one of the best chemicals we've got out there is really an organic chemical. It's a bacteria called Bacillus thuringiensis. It's sold as Dipel or it's BT. And those are products that we can use for these different plants out here, and they will kill these insects, and they're organic in nature, and they just come from the plants that we have, or from the different kind of insecticides. It's very good to do. Now, if this cat here was any good, he could get out here and it would take care of these cabbage worms for us. And that's what we need to do, is train our putty cats to do those kind of things. Right? All right, we're going to take a look at pickles next, and I think this is a very, very interesting crop to look at. First thing we're going to cover is we take a look at the vine that's here. I have male flowers on here and female flowers. There's two different kind of flowers on a pickle plant. Really easy to tell the difference. The females have little pickles underneath the blooms right there. Here's the bloom, there's a little pickle. Here's the bloom, there's a little pickle. The male flowers are down here. The male flowers do not have a little pickles under them. Sometimes people will ask the question, hey, I got all sorts of blooms, but I don't have pickles. Well, go out there and take a look, and maybe all you had was male flowers rather than female flowers. And sometimes they have problems that way. They have difficulty getting those two connected at the same time. And so that's one of the reasons why we can have a little bit of a failure. The other thing about pickles is the pollen from this flower has to get to the pollen on that flower, and that takes a bee or some kind of insect to do that, and sometimes it's even beetles that do that. So if we get carried away with the insecticides and start spraying a lot on pickles, we're not going to get the pollination that we want to have on those plants. And so you got to watch with pickles, and if you ever have to spray them for something, wait till the night when the blooms have closed up for the evening, and they'll do that in the evening. Spray them then, and then once you have sprayed them, the honeybees won't be there. So next morning when them blooms open up, they have already been protected from the insecticide. The insecticide did not get into the inside of them. So that's what we deal with pickle plants and how we deal with them. As we look at this crop right here, that was right here before us, these pickles in the center, that's the old plants, and the leaves are starting to get rough and not too good looking. As you get out around it, the newer leaves that are coming on out are better developed and are very, very green. This plant is really doing very well. It doesn't really have any major insect problems, nor does it have any major disease problems going on with it. But one of the problems that can happen is sometimes we have pickles that just wilt down and die during the season. And when we have that happening, there's a disease, it's a bacterial disease that's carried by bugs that can get into the plant, and it gets vascular. In other words, it gets inside of the plant, and once you've got that, there's nothing you're going to do about it. That disease will take over. So we do have to watch controlling the insects on pickle plants, because we can end up with that disease on it. So that's one of the things we take a look with this plant, and this is something we have to worry about when we deal with pickles. And again, the other thing I'd point out is any kind of type of plant like this that you've got in your garden that's vining, you've got to give them enough room to go. Pickles, cucumbers, watermelons, pumpkins, all those things are vining crops. Give them enough room. And this garden, of course, has a lot of black down. It's not plastic, it's called landscape fabric. It allows it to breathe, the water goes through, and the plant is able to grow on the top of it. It's a lot hotter here, and these plants grow a little bit faster, and you gotta worry about sometimes certain insects will like this hotter environment too, so we've gotta stay on top of that. But that's one of the situations we've got. And these are pickles in this garden, and they're starting to produce. And the other thing is, these are ready to be picked in some cases. Some of these pickles out here are this big. That pickle ought to be taken care of. And that really is a cucumber, not a pickle, of course, at this stage. And until we get that plant pickled, then we can get pickles. But anyway, those cucumbers need to be taken care of before they get to that stage, especially if you are going to pickle them. One of the things I just love to do is just to take a walk around the house and look at all the different disease and insect problems that I can find. And maybe that's one of the reasons why I shouldn't be a house guest at most people's place, because they always end up thinking they got terrible, terrible problems going on there. So I walk out into this orchard, and we take a look at this apple tree that's growing here. And we look up into this apple tree, and you're going to find that there are very few apples on this tree. And the reason for that is probably two different things. Number one, it could have been we had a really late frost, and it caused the apple, the blooms to get killed, or the apples to get killed. That wasn't the case this year. Probably what happened with this tree more than anything else is the fact that there was a heavy crop of apples on this tree last year. And because of that, many trees are what we call biennial bearers. That means they bear heavy one year and light the next year. As we look at this tree, we can find just a very few apples up on this tree, and I suspect this is one of those biennial bearers that's not bearing very well. Another interesting thing about this tree is a disease that we find sometimes in our area, and it's a disease we call cedar apple rust. And this is a really unique disease because it takes two. It takes an apple tree and it takes a cedar tree for this disease to exist. On this tree, we have leaves that look like these here, where they have, on the leaves, yellow spots with black centers in them. That's cedar apple rust. These black centers on the back side of the leaf have a little bit of a fuzzy growth growing outside of it. That fungal spore in those growths will go over to a cedar tree somewhere, infect that cedar tree, and the cedar tree will have little brown balls on it that in the spring of the year will turn into an orange gelatinous mass. And the spores will come out of that gelatinous mass and come over and infect these leaves as they're coming out. And then all season long, we have leaves that look like this with a yellow on it. It's called cedar apple rust. It's a rust disease, and it's very, very common in our area. The way to take care of this disease is very, very simple. And that is, take a look right over here, and you're going to find yourself a cedar tree. Cedars and apples should never be planted close together. And that cedar tree over there should be removed from the property if you're going to have apple trees, because cedar apple rust is a very, very common thing. And I'll never see this problem when there's no cedars around. Arborvita is a type of cedar, and there are also the red cedars also. So all those fall into that category of cedars. And so whenever you have apple trees, you don't need to have any cedars around. So that's the best way to do it, is to eliminate that tree. One of the real common problems we see on apple trees is a disease called apple scab. Apple scab causes these leaves to turn yellow and fall off of it. This year, like a lot of years, we had very wet spring. We've had a lot of apple scab this year, a lot of yellow leaves that have fallen off of trees. Very, very common. But that's what apple scab will look like on this leaf. It's not necessarily this big brown area, but the yellowing and falling off. On the fruit itself, this is what it takes to look like. It'll look like that spot right there. And that spot is one that's caused by this disease. If you're in the apple growing business, especially if you're in the commercial apple growing business, these trees will get sprayed with an insecticide about 12 times a year, insecticide and a fungicide. Well, apple scab is a disease, and it takes a fungicide to do that. And so that's what we're dealing with, that plant. Another thing is this apple over here, we see a little bit of a scar right there on that apple. That's an insect come along called a plum cucurio. It's a beetle with a snout, and it comes along there and it makes a crescent shape, which we see right there, injury into that apple. It lays its egg into that crescent shaped area, and then as that egg hatches out, it develops into a worm and it goes in, and this is the scab that's left over. I hate to use the word scab, the covering that's left over. It's not apple scab, but that's what's left over on this one when we take a look at it. And that's plum cucurio. Really interesting thing about this insect is, if this apple does not drop off the tree, this insect will die because the apple will grow and crush it. So in this case, this is one I just found on the ground. So I suspect this insect died and got crushed on this apple because it should have fell off a long time ago. The other thing that we run into is an insect on trees. As I borrow this knife, we'll take a look. We cut into this apple and we look in the apple and we look for little brown areas, little brown streaks that might be in the apple. There's very few in this, but there's one right there. There's one up through there. Let's do another cut, see if we can find another one on this apple. Don't find that, but I find a whole bunch of picnic beetles. Those are the little black things with the yellow spots on them, and picnic beetles will come in, and they really like to get on something that is out here, and they like to feed on rotting kind of things, and they can get in here too. So that's a picnic beetle there, and there's some more picnic beetles that are in there, and they're actually eating on this fruit. We have picnic beetle damage on a lot of different things. Let's drop that apple. Let's take a look at this one. See if I can see any more of that brown streaking in here. Not too bad. That brown streaking, when I find it, it comes from an insect called an apple maggot, and it'll put little brown runs down in through that area. Lots of time an apple's got apple maggot, it's very, very bumpy on the outside. You can feel that bumps in there. But you know, we got a lot of rots on this apple. We got a lot of things. That's why in Indiana, if you're going to grow apples, you're going to spray them. Otherwise, I guess this might be good applesauce for somebody someday, or maybe even better cider. But growing apples in Indiana is a very difficult thing to do. So don't think about organic apple growing. It's really hard. If you want to get into organic apples, it takes a lot of work to do. This is an interesting plant to me. In agriculture, this is a huge weed. Farmers don't like to have this around. It gets out into fields and it can grow, and it's really hard to kill. But homeowners, on the other hand, really like this plant. They like to have it around because it does attract the hummingbirds. So you be the judge of that. Good plant to have on your place or bad plant to have on your place. It all depends on perspective. And a lot of the things that we deal with in my business, and a lot of things we deal with in agriculture and homeowners and commercial gardening and all those types of things that the Purdue Extension Service works with, sometimes comes down to perspective. And then we talked about a lot of things today. Sometimes we talked about using insecticides and fungicides, and some people don't want to use chemicals, and other people do care about, they will use chemicals. So it's all into what you want to do on your place. And so we try to tell you some of the things that you can do to take care of these problems. Sometimes there's a non-chemical way. There's not a non-chemical way of taking care of things. And if that's the case, maybe we ought to think about not even planting that crop or dealing with that crop on our place. So I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue Extension Service. Glad to have you with us today, and glad to have an opportunity to walk around this yard and just take a look at a few things.